Hi, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to Art After Dark and tonight's exhibition, Insight, Uncovering Histories While Making Art. I am Kate Faulkner. I'm the Director of Public Programs at the Norton, and I just want to thank all of you for being here tonight for this special artist talk. It is my pleasure to welcome tonight's speaker, Adama Delphine Fawundu. Fawundu's works, Maasai to the Present, Nairobi, Kenya, and Maasai Through Sheets, Nairobi, Kenya, from 2014, are featured in the Norton's current exhibition, Origin Stories, Photography of Africa and Its Diaspora. Growing up as a first-generation American to parents from West Africa, Fawundu's work draws from her hybrid cultural upbringing and investigates how traits of indigenous African cultures have transformed and shape-shifted within the African diaspora. Fawundu uses photography, video, sound, mixed media, and bookmaking to create works with themes of memory, displacement, history, identity, utopia, decolonization, fantasy, and Afrofuturism. Origin Stories, Photography of Africa and Its Diaspora, on view now until Sunday, April 17th, considers how contemporary photographers confront the intertwined relationship between identity and colonialism in communities across the African continent and throughout the African diaspora. Featuring works from the Norton's collection, this installation showcases works by celebrated photographers in Africa, the American, the Caribbean, and Europe. I hope you will visit Fawundu's work in the exhibition following tonight's talk. Please welcome Adama Delphine Fawundu.
Good evening, and thank you all for being here. I would like to take a moment of silence for all of those throughout history who have innocently lost their lives and those who continue to lose their lives up until today, innocent people due to the vast amount of violence in our world. Okay. The slide is not working. Okay. All right. I'm going to start with a quote by Saidiya Hartman. "But when does one decide to stop looking to the past and instead conceive of a new order? When is it time to dream of another country or to embrace other strangers as allies or to make an opening or overture where there is none? I'm always thinking about the possibilities and using my imagination to imagine beyond the impossible. I feel like everything that we see today was imagined before it existed, and we do have the power to shape our futures. I am Adama Delphine Fawundu. I am aware that Mende, Bube, and Bamileke cosmologies are intertwined within the fabric of my DNA. I am unaware of the parts of my ancestral being that transformed into my grandpa, Joseph Valcarcel, a descendant of Afro-Cubanos who freely traveled back to Equatorial Guinea to conjoin spirits with my grandma, Margarita Cooper, and give birth to my mother, Maria Valcarcel, in Equatorial Guinea. My spirit feels aligned as the ocean breeze whispers in my ears when my body travels within the landscapes of Nigeria, Sierra Leone, Mali, and Ghana. The sea islands of St. Helena and Dafuski provokes familiar memories that I can't quite grasp. My spirit is calmed with the green fields of Virginia and South Carolina. I often wonder why Sicily feels like home. I am mesmerized and horrified by the songs that the ocean sings, whether it be the Atlantic, Mediterranean, or the Indian. The hums of the rivers, Mississippi, Mano, and the Hudson makes me question exactly what do they remember. It is this connection to the earth that inspires my connection beyond nations and homogeneous identities. I am understanding more and more the earth as one and many places at once, just a minuscule within an overwhelming universe. As an artist, I am seeking connection, uncovering patterns, reconnecting patterns, considering the memory of the body, whether it be my own, the wind, the ocean, the trees, elements of water, water, water bodies. I am the first in my family to be born in America to parents who aligned themselves with Sierra Leone and Equatorial Guinea. Perhaps it is my self-discovery that evolved through the inspiration of hip-hop culture, in addition to the Ama Ata Aidus, Octavia Butler's, Toni Morrison's, Zora Neale Hurston's, and the Fela Kuti's of the world, that keeps me on a never-ending journey, never-ending mission to reveal, love, explore, examine, revel in the intermingling nature of Africa and its diaspora. It is in this place that I ask questions, recognize traumas, find power, seek joy. This is the energy within my body that produces itself in the form of art. As I make art, I'm definitely always researching. Sylvia Arden Boone is a scholar who studied at Yale University, and she was the first African American to be tenured there. Unfortunately, she's no longer with us because she died from cancer, but her intense research on Mende culture has greatly influenced my work. I'm always reading and finding and uncovering histories that are not necessarily made available to us. Always trying to understand in the way that I was educated. And as a child, you know, there was a very biased education that that placed hierarchies on culture. And it's very interesting when in your body, you understand that there's certain things can't be true, and then you go and do the research, and research always agrees with you. I'm also very, very much influenced by writers, and here are some of the writers that I go to often as I'm making work. My work is also inspired heavily by my grandma Adama. She was a textile artist in Sierra Leone, in Pujon, and here are some of her fabrics. I have fabrics over 50 years old. I didn't get to grow up with my grandmother because I was in America. Also, the Civil War in Sierra Leone kept us apart. So I only met her twice in my life, but I had these fabrics with me. So whether in the form of window curtains or dresses or tablecloths, I just started really collecting them, especially or just being aware of them in my presence, especially as I started making art. And you'll see them appear over and over in the work. Here's a piece called Mende Uman, and that is my grandma Adama, and that is my back. I use myself in my work, not necessarily as a self-portrait, but as a symbol. And even making this piece, I was thinking about fabric. It's a piece that is printed on fabric, the same fabric that that people dye on. So I often juxtapose the photograph on different materials as a way to interrogate the identity of the photograph, and you'll see that transform over this presentation. I'm going to share with you a series called The Sacred Star of Isis, and this quote is really important to me as I think about the diaspora and the way that, again, that we think about history. It's from The Philosophy of the Sea by Asaba Irobi. It is very important to note that Africans who survived the Middle Passage were physically and spiritually the strongest of the race. They arrived in the New World not only as resistant triumphs to the unnameable horrors done to the human body and spirit in the castles and ships, but also as living, thinking embodiments of ritual, medicinal, agricultural, political, music, artistic, organizational, philosophical ideas and knowledges from old and complex cultures in Africa, such as the Yorubas, the Igbos, the Iwe, Dogon, Wolof, Zulu, Kikuyu, and among many others. I feel like it's really important to keep that in our minds as we talk so loosely about slavery and colonialism, that there is this long generation of history and knowledge that we hold in our bodies, and the power happens when we tap into that and to create new things. I also think that where we are today in this world is we're facing issues such as climate change, that we need to really think about what indigenous cultures were doing with the earth, because they knew how to care for the earth, and they weren't primitive or uncivilized. They definitely had a lot of knowledge in order to know how to commune and be with the earth. And we've been disconnected to that, and that's why we face where we are today. That's why we are where we are today. Here's another person who has definitely inspired my research, Edouard Glissant. The way he also talks about that memory and the repetition through the body. And not that there's, the beauty in it is that there's never one, there's not a lineage, it's not one line, but there's so many different multiples that start somewhere but then spreads out, which is actually amazing. So this piece here, I'm gonna show you some series. Here's a series called Passageways. And Passageways, I'm thinking about that memory. And again, I use myself and sometimes family members in the work. This is my mom. But this is really thinking about the personal connection, but then the connection of knowledge between myself and my family, but also between Africa and the diaspora. So again, I use myself, but I'm also thinking as of the larger community as well. And I also, the borders, is fabric that I collect. I collect fabric that's made in the same fashion that my grandmother made her fabric with. So either I'm using her fabric or I'm using other materials. The dress that I'm wearing in both pieces was hand-dyed by my grandmother and then also given as a gift to my mother, and then now I'm wearing it. So I think about these materials. Everything in the work is always there for a reason. And I think about even something like that. What does it mean? Like, what does this fabric hold? And again, even that fabric is that symbol of generations upon generations and all that knowledge that we hold in our bodies. I'm also always juxtapositioning even fabrics that may evoke memories of domestic nature to them. And also from other histories, I like to juxtapose these, and I made these collages called Body Vernacular. If you saw these in person, they're all printed on paper, but they're often, people often think that they're actual fabrics because of the rich texture and the way that I make them. And I do that on purpose because I'm also thinking about the way that we perceive people based on their outward identities. And sometimes you really just need to know who people are before we decide who we think they are. And so I used, again, for the photography as a way to disrupt the medium and play with its identity. I also, if you notice, like so many of the photos are some form of collage. I think of the way that identity is made by sampling different cultures or different identities, and we're all this multitude, we're one body but representing so many. And I use that approach to make my films as well. So here's a film called The Cleanse that I made back in 2018. And the way that I made the film was by piecing words from authors who I respect to make a new language, and then also use my hair as a symbol of transformation. And thought about the cleanse in terms of like, how do we really assess what's in our minds? How do we reflect on the society that we're in and start transforming in order to change what we want to? So here's the cleanse. This is a 5-minute sample, but the video is actually 10 minutes long. Oh.
Hey, And that's gonna make me dance. And that's gonna make me dance. Make it rain, tree. 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 Make it rain, tree.
Where there is a woman, there is magic. If there is a moon falling from her mouth, she is a woman who knows her magic. Who can share or not share her powers. A woman with a moon falling from her mouth, roses between her legs and tiaras of Spanish moss. This woman is a consort of the spirits. And there are three that bear witness in earth, the spirit, and the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one. And he who sends down from time to time water from the sky in due measure, and we raise to life therewith a land that is dead, even so will you be raised from the dead. My grandmother always talked about how we lost our language here, stained with another's past as well as our own. Their past in my blood. I am a blood. Let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, our bodies washed with pure water.
Make it rain, tree. 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 Make it rain, tree.
The song is branded with the new world. I'm the girl who had to sleep with her master and mistress. My father, the master. My daughter's father. And the father of my daughter's daughter. How many generations, days that were pages of hysteria, our survival depending on suppressed hysteria. This is how I look without makeup, and with no bra, my ninnies sag down low. My hair ain't never hung down to my shoulders, and it might not grow. Let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life. Sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
Make it rain, tree. 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 Make it rain, tree.
Oh, you who believe, when you rise to observe the Salat, you shall wash your faces, your arms to the elbows, and wipe your heads and your feet to the ankles. There is neither time nor place for us here, unless we create it. I found God in myself, and I loved her. I loved her fiercely.
So that's the cleanse. And again, so that was made by what I consider to be a found poem. So it was just all the words came from so many different sources that was used to create this new element. And the chanting was, comes from Mende culture, from the Mendianti, and it's Mendiada, and it's a call for rain. And so I took that call for rain along with a trap song calling from rain, another trap song, and, you know, making it into this new thing of calling for water and thinking about the power and transformation in water and the identity and how, you know, that fluctuates. Water gives us life. Water could take away life. You know, so I'm thinking about all of that, those different complexities when it comes to identity. Even in my mixed media work, I like to take different materials and put them together to make something new. So the bottom piece here is made from the raffia, the brown raffia, well, tannish raffia comes from Sierra Leone. When I was in Savannah, I got some sea moss and that came into the work. There's hair, there's fabrics from my grandmother's collection and then also from Nigeria. So there's all of these different collage. I love to collage materials and juxtapose them against each other, and again to make these new languages. Here's another excerpt of a video in the same way, but this video was made now with me moving around the world. And so you may have a scene from Sierra Leone juxtaposed to Harlem, to Argentina. Like there's so many different parts of the diaspora that comes together.
Ya sabe, vea mi llego el homaque. Ya sabe, vea mi llego el homaque. Doy el pe a cao. Ya doy el pe a cao. Ya. Ya may doy el pe a cao. Ya. Ya. Doy el pe a cao. Ya doy el pe. Doy el pe a cao. Ya.
So with that video was called Deep Inside I'm Blue, and I was really thinking about the power of energy to move through these different places in the earth. I'm heavily inspired by African deities, particularly water deities, and I think it's really interesting how you have these water deities such as Yemaya, for example, who is known all over the world, and I find that to be really interesting. And so I kind of take on that transformation or that kind of shape-shifting nature and put that into the work as I'm making the video. So this movement, everything has this movement in slow motion, but yeah, it's definitely thinking about that part of the body that has memory, that is an archive, that continues to transform, that continues to evolve, but also definitely move, right? Sometimes I look at the ocean and I think about the energy that allows the ocean to move and how that also allows our bodies to be in sync with the moon. And, you know, thinking about our feminine bodies that are lunar bodies and how we're connected to the universe, you know? And I think like the more that we start connecting into that, we would hopefully start connecting more to each other, because that same energy is what's necessary to cause a shift, hopefully a shift that's good for all of us. Here is a series called Here We Are, Energy, Mass, Life. And I'm always, again, thinking constantly in conversation with my grandmother's textiles. And so these are all printed on fabric, but then I'm also sewing into the fabrics. I work with hair and cotton a lot, as well as symbols. Here's another one. The face on this, which is a face in my mind, has a cowry shell from Sierra Leone, some more sea moss from Savannah, and the raffia is all from Sierra Leone, but then my hair goes into it. So it's always kind of this conjuring of new beings. And then all of these beings are water beings, whether we see the water or not. This one I made in Argentina, and I thought it was really interesting because Argentina has a history of openly denying their African heritage. And so something like that, when we talk about uncovering histories, it's so interesting that the tango, which is the national dance, actually comes from Congo and is related to Candombe, which, and when we think about tango, is really coming from Shango, which is the god of thunder. And so imagine how much that adds to understanding a culture rather than erasing the culture. So I think that the more that we get into that spirit, again, we open up so many new possibilities for us just as a human race. So I embodied in this photo a dress that came from Argentina that was known during a particular time. And then imagine, like, what is this new being that I'm creating against these colonial walls? In the Face of History is a series that I started in 2018, where I started doing was taking this photo of myself and screen printing them to be symbolic of this person looking into the past, but also in the present. And so I thought about that, combining the past, present, and the future, because literally we all just existed in the past, present, and future, and we continue to. So thinking about what does it mean again to interrogate history, and because no matter what we say about the past, what we think we know about the past informs how we see the present and how we behave today. So what I did, I am definitely someone who loves to be in the archives, and this probably was just secretly just my, you know, I probably did this project so I could just have so much time to spend in libraries and looking up information. But here it is, amassed all of these different documents from so many different parts of history within the United States, but also around the world. So whenever I install this, I also go put a lot of emphasis on the location in which the exhibition will take place. So for this one that was in New Haven, there was so much that had to do with that particular space. But when people come to the exhibit, what happens is they automatically go into the documents and they start questioning. And then it's I listen a lot to, oh my God, look at this, did you know that? And I think it's something, you know, to get us engaged in that. Because it definitely does something to the way that we think about each other and our futures. I had the opportunity to take this project to Usher Fort in Accra, Ghana, and it was interesting even to, you know, to show the cleanse there, but also put documents on actual historical spaces as well, and activate those audiences in a different way. During the pandemic, pre-pandemic, I was commissioned by the Park Avenue Armory to create a project that was related to the celebration of women having the right to vote. And so I wanted to do a cape. I automatically thought about these documents, and I knew I would do something within the Face of History. I knew I wanted to, but this time, instead of printing it on paper, to print it on fabric, and I was gonna make this quilt that was just gonna move in the space. But then the pandemic happened, and we were told we can't have an in-person exhibit. It has to be something digital. I've always been obsessed with capes and also with the idea of making something to wear. So then in that mist of craze that I was in New York, I don't know what it was like here, but New York was a nightmare, and making art was the only thing that literally saved me from just going into a deep, deep, deep depression. So engaging in this process, I actually hand sewed and machine, not all hand, but hand and machine sewed a cape out of these documents. And the documents all mostly, I mean, it's of course looking at women in the United States who were fighting for the right to vote, but I also had a focus on African-American women who were involved in this, because I think that goes unnoticed as well. So here is an excerpt. What I did is I made this video. The video was actually a process of me making the cape and performing in the cape. And then it turned out that a part of the video, you know, we had that election coming up and everything, and I was curious about, you know, since this had to do with voting, to talk to some women and non-binary people about their ideas around voting. And it ended up that after making this video, which was about 9 minutes long, this organization, 100 Women Strong, asked me if they could use an excerpt in their as they were promoting voting around the country. So the video ended up being used in multiple ways. One, as an actual tool to promote voting, and then also in its form for the project. And so I'll just play an excerpt. This is the promo that we did for that.
As much as, you know, it is about go vote, it is about disrupting and dismantling every system that has built in this country on white supremacy that oppresses us, which includes our democratic process.
The realities that we face is that this is the system that's in place. What's the alternative for us in our communities if we don't vote? We need to disrupt the system. But my question is, can we disrupt the system from inside? Is it one or the other? Is it voting or disrupting the system? Or do we encourage people to vote as we're finding ways to dismantle or disrupt systemic racism?
So how do we actually break out of these systems that we have been sort of sequestered into the last several hundred years? Beyond, you know, just us being Black people, us being Black women, as people in this country, what is the new thing? Because obviously what we have is not working. The fact that the streets are on fire across the country is obviously, you know, speaking to that.
And so it's not enough to just go vote as is, but how can we reimagine and rebuild a democracy that includes us as full citizens and not only 3/4?
How do we do something else? What is the new thing? What are the new systems that we can build?
How are we exploring a beloved community and a visionary future where we are not just surviving, but we are thriving, like where we are not on defense, but we are telling people what we want and then we get it.
And here are some photos of the cape. It was interesting because this, I live in Brooklyn near the Prospect Park, and in Prospect Park houses the Leffertart house, which was a plantation. And so it was interesting to also perform this cape in front of that historical site as well. Okay. And so another project that I worked on was called Sun Sum in Mind, Body, and Spirit. And it was in communication with the scholar Anton Willem Amo, who was a very well-regarded German and African scholar in Germany during the 1700s. And so just to put it in perspective, he was a contemporary of Immanuel Kant. And of course, many people don't know who he is. So for me, it was, when I was asked to be a part of this, it's right up my lane to kind of go into this material and then see what work that I can make and also expose who Amo was. After this exhibition was seen in Berlin, they created the Anton Willem Amo Way, and now they're, and it first happened in Braunschweig, Germany, and they named the in the museum they had, they now have the Anton Wilhelm Ammo wing, and then in Berlin there's Anton Wilhelm Ammo way, and his work was centered around the body, the mind, and the spirit, something that I think about a lot. And so I was really interested even beyond the fact that who he was. He was he was actually given as a gift to the Duke of Braunschweig, and then was raised in Germany, and then went to school and did everything and became this well-regarded person. But because of the racism that he experienced in Germany, it was too much for him. So he went back to Ghana. And it was interesting because in Ghana, he kind of didn't fit in there either, because here he is just, you know, caught in between too many places. But it was really interesting just to see that he's also one of the first people at that time to even start to talk about the diaspora, you know, which is so interesting when we start to think about how people were engaging in the past. You know, sometimes I think we're all caught up in our 1900s world. But so I made a video. This video also made in that similar fashion of sampling these different places. Here, it's between Braunschweig, Germany. I was really interested in the waterways and thinking about the earth as this memory holder, always moving. And then also I sampled words from Audre Lorde and a poet named May Ayim. May Ayim was from Germany. She was adopted by German parents, but her ancestry was linked to Ghana. And she did suffer from, you know, depression, and a lot of her work was fighting against racism. She ended up, unfortunately, dying from suicide. And Audre Lorde, I thought it was really interesting to bring her into this project that I was still thinking about the diaspora. But if we know, she was in Berlin talking to women around about feminism. And it was just really interesting to sample her voice and these German voices and to make this short film. But again, these are just small excerpts. This film is like about 9 minutes long as well, but I'm going to show you a short version.
Right. Ich werde trotzdem afrikanisch sein. Auch wenn ihr mich gerne Deutsch haben wollt. Und werde trotzdem Deutsch sein. Auch wenn euch meine Schwärze nicht passt. At the shoreline, standing upon the constant edges of decision, crucial, alone, coming and going in the hours between dawn, looking inward and outward, at once before and after, seeking nows. For those of us who live at the shoreline, for those of us standing live upon at the shoreline, edges of decision, live upon the constant edges of decision, upon the crucial edges, coming and going in the hours between dawn, coming and going in the hours between outward, and once looking inward and outward, seeking now, before and outward, seeking now.
For the sake of time, I'm gonna move on. I also made a book. Bookmaking is something that I like to do, and I made this book in a intuitive way. I didn't know what the outcome was going to be, so I started off with a large sheet of mulberry paper and collage both sides, and then folded it down, and the end product again just created itself. So here are excerpts of the book. And then I'll share another project with you She caught the Holy Ghost and it looked like this. I was asked to do, I also did this project during the pandemic. I was doing a lot of editing, thank goodness, and work during the pandemic. And I say, not as if we're not still in the pandemic, but when I say that, I'm talking about in the midst of it in 2020. But it was really exciting for me to be in conversation with the Pentecostal church in terms of the Black church in the South, because I think that energy that I'm talking about definitely moves through there. And it's something that, you know, people may deny and call it this or that, but I think it's really interesting how it makes its way in the, you know, in the church. So here's another video. And I'm just going to play a little bit of it, but this is, if you've ever heard of the term someone catching the Holy Ghost, this is my imagination of what that would look be, what that would feel like, or what the experience would be.
God Almighty, God Almighty, God.
Say with all of my work, it's really about what you feel, and everyone is going to feel something different. I know the things that I'm working out, but I really make work less about interpretation but more about what happens here. I'll end with this series for Grandma Adama, and it is a collaboration with my grandmother's spirit, which is most of my work, but this is really more intentional, where I started making digital patterns, and then I made negatives from these patterns, and then used various photographic processes in order to interpret them. And so these are all made through cyanotypes, and they're printed on Guinea brocade fabric from Sierra Leone. And I spent, yeah, so there, and the interesting thing is that there's all these identities that I start with, and they find themselves in all the different interpretations of these fabrics. So you could actually trace them all. And so this is what it's looking like. Some close-ups of it. And here I'm abstracting of course, you don't see any physical bodies in here, but it's definitely all about that body memory again. I made these ones are all digital collages, but again, if you look in them, if you saw them in person, you'll be able to see traces of the bigger pieces in the smaller ones. Some are blown up, and these were all printed on rice paper. Some of them you can't see it now, but if you look at the first one, there's hair sewn into them. So they're very delicate and they do move in the space. Here are close-ups. And then this one, and again, these are all cameraless photographic processes. So this is a silver gelatin print that I made first, and then I screen printed over them. Again, all with these negatives that were made from the fabrics. And there's a whole, I have like about 40 of those, and they all are different. They're all like one of ones. And then these were made through their RC paper, and they were actually made, they're photo lumen, so they were made outside in the sun. Here are some close-ups. And so what I did is I still used those same negatives and had them sitting out in the sun for hours. Like sometimes I'll put them out in the morning and then come back in the afternoon to get them. But then I also use linoleum stamping. So I carved in these different shapes into the material and then stamped those on top, and then use hair and some metal, a whole bunch of different things to make these unique pieces again. And this is where I am now, which are, again, these are all photographic processes. The middle piece is with the hands raised. That's fabric. It's one of the oldest fabrics that I have from my grandmother. And then if you see the shapes in the back, it's the first set that I showed you. And those are actually masks. Those are bundle masks that I just kind of put together to make a shape to use as a negative. And then that ends up here. So these were made through UV sensitive inks. So it's like a photographic ink that responds to light. And this is a double-sided image. So what you're seeing is the front and the back of the image. And it's just the beginning. It's a work in progress, but these are gonna be long pieces that are gonna stand in the space like beings and, you know, move on their own. And this is where I will leave us. That's it. Thank you so much. And if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer.
Anyone would like to use the mic with their question?
Hi, I noticed a lot of your, you're obviously in a lot of your own photographs, and I wonder, do you set up and take the photograph yourself, or do you have a collaborator who's assisting you as a photographer? And
most of the time, I'm using a timer, and I set it up on my own. And then the only times that I use someone else is if I'm in a position, like I have some photos that I'm in the middle of the water, or I'm somewhere where it's just impossible to set it up and run. But and when I do that, I'm usually framing it out and then telling the person, okay, now, you know what I mean? So I'm always mapping them out ahead of time. But for the most part, it's actually kind of difficult to do as well because of focusing. Like you want to make sure you're in the right position to focus. So yeah, so it's both. Like the ones upstairs, I had no one to help me. Yeah.
Adama, do you mind just mentioning a little bit about your upcoming projects?
Okay, well, this summer, I'm also a professor at Columbia University, and I just got a research grant through the school to continue my water body series, which this is the first of that. And what I'm going to do is travel to the South to do more research around the Gullah and the Geechee cultures, which take place on the sea islands of South Carolina and Georgia and Florida. So I am very excited about going to Charleston because Charleston has a lot of archives there. And I'll also be going to St. Helena and back to Dafuski. I first got introduced to the Gullah and Geechee culture back in 1998. And that's when I went to, and if you saw on one of the earlier slides, it said there was a house that said Praise House. And that was taken back in 98. And I was so amazed to go because what drew me there is because I'm from Sierra Leone, and there is a you know, a research link between the Gullah people and the people, the Mende, not only the Mende, but the Yoruba and just African cultures. But when I went with my sister and my son, and we ate red rice, which was jollof rice, and we understood the language. Like, I totally understand Gullah, which is amazing to me, you know, because it's so similar to the Creole that my mother, you know, that I grew up listening to with my mom. So I want to do more research there, because I'm really interested in these cultures that retain so much of their heritage, in spite of the things put in place, such as slavery, to annihilate them from their culture. So I think that it's really powerful, because it's evidence to what the body holds and how the body just insists on resisting and living, right? And so that's what I'm interested in. So I'll be doing that research, more of that research this summer. I'm also doing a residency in Maine in June, where I will be visiting communities again that held on to that culture. I'm really interested in the sea island. The Fawundus are from a sea island called Mano, which is off the coast of Sierra Leone. And they too, they were Krim, they were engulfed under the Mende culture, but they too are a community that has been fighting for years for their sovereignty. So I think about this idea of like how we have this, we just want to group people together and say, you're this, you're that. And we're not. We're so different, and it's okay to be different, you know? In Sierra Leone alone, there are over 100 different cultures that have distinct ways of being on the earth. They're not, what is Sierra Leone? It's a nation that someone came up with the name Land of the Sleeping Lions and called it this place. It has nothing to do with the people, right? So I think it's really interesting that there's so much information. If we go to Mende, if we go to Krim, if we go to Yoruba, if we go to Timini, if we go, you know, I could go on and on and on. You have complete different languages. And we know that language is the key to a culture and the way of being. So I'm interested in that. I feel like getting that knowledge, it really helps you to again, understand that we exist beyond these social and political hierarchies that are put in place. We don't have to, like, do this. We can live much better. So I'm interested in putting information out there to inspire us to think differently. Yeah.
Hello, I have a question about the way you work with the archives in your projects. Mm-hmm. And if you could explain a little bit about how you sort through that material and what gets chosen to be instilled in a project, like your editing process, I guess, would mm-hmm. be the best way to talk about that.
Yes, that's a really good question. Thank you for that question. I usually start in one place. Like, so for example, I was interested, like even with the voting, right? I was like, okay, well, who were the people who were active, you know, in the women's suffrage movement? So I will go into the archive and start looking. And then what happens is I will be one place, and then that will lead me somewhere else. And then it leaves, and I go on the trips. I allow myself to research in an intuitive way, because it's the same way that I'm making work. So I don't like to only end in these one, you know, these places. I allow myself to learn new information. And because of that, I'm finding out all of these amazing things. And whatever stands out to be something that I don't think a whole bunch of people are privy to, that's what gets into the shows.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.